On Wish You Were Here this week, I go island hopping in the Seychelles. Anna Walker is on a fly drive in Orlando and northwest Florida. And John Carter's in Germany, enjoying a city break in Dresden. And you could win a fabulous £10,000 holiday of a lifetime in our telephone competition.
In a year when package holiday bookings are well down, Florida is expecting a record 1.5 million British holidaymakers. I discover some resorts not yet in the brochures and catch up on an old favourite.
Lots of holidaymakers go back to the same resort each year because it never changes. But here in Orlando, people keep returning because it's constantly changing. This is one of the latest attractions, the Tower of Terror.
It's everyone's nightmare, the lift that plunges 13 stories.
Oh, I lost my stomach on that one.
The Tower of Terror is at Disney MGM Studios, part of Disney World, the leisure empire that sparked off a tourist explosion in Florida and turned Orlando into the theme park capital of the world. It's now among the most popular attractions for Brits abroad, a place where nothing stays quite the same for very long.
Well, when you think of Disney, you automatically think of Mickey Mouse, but meet my new friends, Buzz Lightyear and Woody.
They are, of course, the main characters from the latest Disney film, Toy Story. For those who haven't seen it yet, it's a tale of two toys who find themselves competing for affection and facing the real-life dangers of the outside world. The Daily Parade is a kind of preview. Toy Story is the first fully computer-generated feature film in movie history. Films are actually made here at Disney. A backstage tram tour reveals a few secrets.
There are no backs or insides to any of these homes. This house was home to the Emmy award-winning Golden Girls. Director Steven Spielberg used this army tank and these other military-looking vehicles in Indiana Jones and the Last Crusade. To create this rain, we used high-powered water spouts located overhead just out of camera range.
There's good news for holidaymakers on a budget. The new themed All-Star Resorts Hotel is the first at Disney to offer on-site accommodation at reasonable cost, with free transport provided to all the main areas. But wherever you stay, children can be left under supervision at the Neverland Club, while parents enjoy a night out on their own.
It might look like I've moved to downtown New York, but thanks to Disney MGM Studios' trickery, I'm still in Orlando. And I'm still in New York, but this is Universal Studios' version of the Big Apple.
Like Disney, nothing here is quite what it seems. Next to New York, you'll find the well-filmed streets of Los Angeles and San Francisco. And then there's a seaside town called Amity, where they had a little trouble with an overgrown shark a few years ago. You can hear all about it on a peaceful boat ride around the pretty harbour.
Now, the first point of interest on the tour is over to your port side.
More technical wizardry on a New York tram ride, new levels of road rage, confrontation.
No, don't shoot, Ivy, do not shoot!
And no self-respecting studio theme park would be without its stunt show. Coming this summer, the latest in high-tech, Terminator 2 and Battle Across Time.
Every single thing you see here is associated with the movies in some way or another, and you may recognise these cars from the film American Graffiti.
And just like the movies, cars themselves are an American way of life. Every Saturday in Kissimmee, the world's oldest and largest car cruise parades past pavements axle-deep with admirers. Up to 500 models spanning some 60 years. A glistening roll call of all-American motoring. For many, though, the night starts with a meal after a queue at Disney's newest and currently most fashionable restaurant, where, once again, movies provide the main theme. Then, for serious clubbers, it's Pleasure Island, rock bands, jazz bands, and shows that don't really get going until around midnight. After all the hype and razzmatazz of the theme parks, it's quite a relief to get back to nature. And it doesn't take long. Cypress Island Nature Reserve is only 30 minutes from Orlando. The activities here include horse riding. Now I'm off to Northwest Florida's Emerald Coast. It's a long 7-hour drive, but then this huge state is the size of Britain.
This is Grayton Beach. Out of 650 beaches in the whole of the US, this has been voted the number one. That's because of the purity of the water and the quality of the sand. It's just like caster sugar, and it's so white because it's quartz.
For some 26 miles, the bleached beaches of South Walton skirt the Gulf of Mexico between Panama City and Destin. They're not yet in the tour operators' brochures. No big chain hotels, fast food eateries or t-shirt stalls line the seafront. Only the occasional high-rise Mars stretches of dazzling sand and dunes. Frankly, they look much better inside than out. The quality of self-catering apartments is pretty high. This resort is actually called Seaside. It was built in the 1980s as a social experiment to recreate the spirit of community living and encourage neighbourliness. Once here, you can forget about the car. From your large rented home, everything you want is never more than a 10-minute stroll away, and that includes the very upmarket street market. It has a touch of the Mediterranean about it. South Walton is a string of small beach communities. Unlike the rest of Florida, the winter is off-season, so prices are lower. It's also cooler. Average temperatures are mere 68 degrees Fahrenheit. Sunny enough, though, for a tan. And there's still plenty going on.
The most popular two-centre holidays combine Orlando with the nearby West Coast resorts. But it really is worth driving just a few extra hours up here to the northwest to discover a less crowded and less commercialised stretch of the Florida coast.
A 14-night fly drive starting in Orlando costs from £279 per person, based on two adults, return charter flights and car hire, but no accommodation. The operator is UniJet America.
If anywhere deserves the brochure cliché, a tropical paradise, it surely has to be the Seychelles. They're 1,000 miles from anywhere, sprinkled across the Indian Ocean, halfway between Africa and India. Of the 110 islands, the largest is Mahé.
Over 100,000 people from all over the world come to the Seychelles every year, and the vast majority stay in big hotels like this on a standard package holiday.
But with an increasing number of guest houses and self-catering apartments around the islands, more and more holidaymakers are travelling independently and making their own arrangements.
How easy is it to do it yourself? And is it any cheaper?
Right on Mahé's lovely Beau Vallon Bay, I found Le Petit Village, 7 spacious and well-designed apartments. The Seychelles is one of the world's most expensive holiday destinations, but self-catering helps keep costs down.
It's your turn to be waited on now, Abdul.
Oh, thank you.
Families who run guest houses and apartments are only too happy to pass on insiders' advice on things to see and do. But for the first couple of days, most of us just want to crash out. You'll find plenty of good local restaurants if you can't be bothered to cook. And for a treat, try the Bagatelle, set in 5 acres of landscape gardens.
Well, this restaurant specialises in seafood and Creole cooking, and Creole dishes use lots of aromatic spices and herbs, all grown on the islands. This is Sea and Surf. It's red snapper and island prawns.
Victoria is the only town in the Seychelles and one of the world's smallest capitals.
looks familiar? It's Little Ben, a tiny hand-wound replica of its big brother in London. It looks down the high street, where you'll find the tourist board and most of the island's main travel agencies. You should obviously do some homework before you leave home. And the Seychelles Tourist Board in London will send you an impressive amount of brochures. And you should definitely book at least 2 nights accommodation in advance, because it would be terrible to come halfway across the world and then find you'd nowhere to stay.
A local travel agent should be the independent traveller's first stop. They can give you personal advice, help you budget, and surprisingly, it's often cheaper booking hotels through them than direct. So, armed with the information I need, where better to map out an itinerary than the Pirate's Arms, Victoria's main watering hole and meeting place? I'll certainly be booking a trip to one of the Seychelles' remoter islands. But first, let's hit the road and explore Mahé. A mini-moke is the coolest way of getting about. The roads are pretty good and you drive on the left. First stop, the gallery of Michael Adams, the Seychelles' best-known artist. He paints the richness of local life and his inspiration is all around him. The Seychelles are unique, the only mid-ocean granite islands in the world.
It's these massive granite boulders that make the landscape, and especially the beaches here on the Seychelles, different from other tropical islands. When you're driving around the island, you might be lucky enough to see a giant tortoise like this one, because lots of hotels have them as pets. They can live up to 200 years old. This one is 97, but there's life in the old tortoise yet, I can tell you.
Now, self-catering means shopping. You'll feel quite safe at Victoria's friendly market.
No idea what that is at all.
In fact, anything that looks familiar is probably imported and therefore very expensive.
You pay 25 rupees for this cabbage, that's just about £3, whereas you can have all this for the same money, including the splendid papaya and the passion fruit.
After the break, I go island hopping. And John Carter's in a reborn city, that's Dresden. A popular excursion from Mahé takes you to nearby Round Island. You can experience the coral reefs without even getting your feet wet through the windows of a semi-submersible.
Now I know what a goldfish feels like. I'm in the tank.
The protected reefs of the St. Anne Marine National Park teem with scores of different fish. The day out includes time for snorkeling and lunch on Round Island, where they serve up tender tuna steaks and delicious aubergine fritters in an idyllic setting. And after the meal, there's time to pad around the beaches. Now for that other coral island I planned to visit. Isolated Desroches is an hour's flight from Mahé. Travelling in small planes adds to the excitement and the expectation of island hopping. No arrival lounge here, but from the airstrip a corridor takes you straight into the only hotel, where a drink of coconut milk refreshes all new guests. The standard of accommodation at Desroches Lodge Resort is high. It compares well to bed and breakfast rates on other islands, which average around £70 a night for two. There are no proper roads on Desroches, but you can cycle along tracks through the shady coconut groves. The resident population is just 15 people, and cycling through the tiny village and farmyard brings you to beautiful beaches. There's always one to yourself.
Lots of lovely sunshine today and it's in the high 80s. But it does rain most of the year, usually in short, sharp bursts. The wettest season, though, is from November to February. Strangely enough, that's when it's most expensive to come here.
Seychelles may seem expensive compared to, say, Britain, but it depends what you're getting in exchange for your money. Here, the location and the service is very special. It's a lovely place and I think it's value for money.
Scuba diving is rated highly throughout the Seychelles, and on Desroches there's qualified instruction with introductory one-day courses for beginners. If you can swim, you can snorkel and still see the wonders of the underwater world. It's a dawn start for some big game fishing and a rod-bending exercise that reels in first a small bonito tuna and then a huge sailfish. So finally, what's the verdict on making your own holiday arrangements?
Travelling independently as opposed to on a package, you get the more remote locations where there are fewer people that hopefully are less spoilt and more interesting.
This is our first trip to the Seychelles, and we chose the Seychelles because we wanted somewhere warm and sunny and somewhere that was quiet and where we could relax. And it has definitely lived up to our expectations.
No holiday here is cheap, and in fact, the more islands you visit, the more expensive it becomes. But to stay in one hotel on one island for the whole time is a complete waste. It really would be tragic to do that, and you wouldn't get value for money. Individually, these islands are really quite special. Now, the cost of getting to the Seychelles. Prices fluctuate depending on season and airline, but until the end of June, the Air Seychelles return fare to Mahé is £475 from Manchester, £499 from Gatwick.
Because it was so grand and graceful, they called it once the Florence of the North, but that was before the bombs fell more than 50 years ago. Today, Dresden is still rising from the rubble. Here, all you see is relatively new, no matter how old it may appear.
The only thing most people know about Dresden is that it was bombed to virtual extinction at the end of World War II. But this is more than a city rising from its ashes.
Even so, work is still going on to repair the devastation of February the 13th, 1945.
The magnificent Church of Our Lady was reduced to rubble on that night, having dominated the Dresden skyline for over 200 years. Of all the restoration projects going on in the city, this is the most significant.
Until recently, the plan was to leave this as a ruin, a reminder of what happens when men wage total war. But the plan changed, and now the Frauenkirche will be completely restored by 2006, the 800th anniversary of this city's foundation. It's hard to tell that these buildings are post-war replacements for the 18th and 19th century originals. Air pollution has blackened the stonework, adding its own deceptive patina of age. A lot of work was done between the end of the war and the fall of the wall under the old regime, but reminders of that regime are apparently an embarrassment today. Despite what Kipling claimed, East and West meet and mingle sometimes uneasily in Dresden, a city where 250 tower cranes swing over the skyline. The Hofkirch, the Opera House, the Royal Palace are all restorations. But some things survived the war. In Augustusstrasse, 25,000 Meissen tiles depict the 90-year-old Procession of the Princes and Wilhelm Walther, its creator. But as I said, there's much more to Dresden than the restoration of its buildings. There are parks and gardens to be enjoyed, museums to be visited, and fun to be had. A miniature railway runs through Grossgarten, Dresden's largest park. It's operated by children outside school hours, though I don't think they get a chance to do any of the driving. When it comes to more conventional travel, taxis are on the expensive side, but the city has one of the most extensive tram systems in Europe. Unusually, tram and bus fares are based on the time the journey takes, not on the distance. A locally based company claims to have the world's oldest and largest fleet of paddle steamers. We traveled on the Deisbar, built in 1884. Her coal-fired engines were made in Glasgow. From May to November, they run excursion trips on the River Elbe, upstream and down. The trick, though, is to go upstream by road and return by boat, so cutting the journey time in half and giving yourself a variety of scenery. Our trip upriver took us to the sandstone pinnacles of Saxony, Switzerland. Dresden only has modern hotels, but they don't all look modern. What was a ruin on my previous visit has been completely restored, and so well that you can't tell the old from the new. It opened at the beginning of 1995 as a very grand hotel. Dresden has masses of snack bars, food stalls, and pavement cafes. However, their idea of a light snack is a substantial plateful, and service is irritatingly slow.
You'll probably want to take your time over your evening meal, but it'll be useful to have a few words of German, because menus in English, like English speakers, are a bit thin on the ground.
If you also want food for the soul, then eat early and go to the opera, or simply digest the architecture. In the half dozen years since I was last in Dresden, this city has been completely transformed, and by that I don't just mean the restoration work. No, you can measure the change in the spirit of this city, which is poised to become once again the Florence of the North. 3 nights at the Hotel Ibis costs from £358 per person based on two sharing and includes bed and breakfast, flights and transfers. The operator is DER Travel Service.
Well, I wish I was in Cape Town, where I was brought up. I spent my childhood there. The weather's fantastic. I'd like to be on top of Table Mountain this very minute. I wish I was there.
You could be there or on one of our specially selected dream holidays, like previous winner Mr. Kopak, a holiday that could be valued up to £10,000 in this week's competition. Just answer this question. In which ocean are the Seychelles? Is it A, the Atlantic, or B, the Indian? All you have to do is call 0891 20 10 20. That's 0891 20 10 20. And lines are open until midnight on Tuesday. And that's it for this series of Wish You Were Here. We do hope you've enjoyed our reports, and before we leave you, here are some of the highlights. We'll be back next winter with a new series of Wish You Were Here, reporting once again from destinations all around the world. Until then, have a good summer and happy holidays.
When in Rio, another travel tip from SEAT Cars.
Information's available from Wish You Were Here, sponsored by SEAT Cars. For a fact sheet produced in association with Teletext on ITV and Channel 4, send a large stamped addressed envelope to Wish You Were Here, Fact Sheet 21, P.O. Box 50, Bromley, BR29TT. Or for a fact sheet summary and this week's competition question, turn to Teletext on ITV page 261.